Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you because of the gathering together today around the table of the Lord. We thank you, Father, because this word is so important. And it is more important than our physical food, than any other thing that we have here on earth. We bless your name, O Lord, because you've given us this word. Not only that you have given us your word, you have given us the Spirit of the Lord to interpret the word and to apply the word in every heart. We thank you because you have not taken a teacher away from us. Lord, one of the greatest things you have done for us is to give us the Bible, give us your Spirit, and give us the interpreter, and give us the teacher to teach us the word. We pray that this privilege will never be taken away from us in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, I pray that as you help me and use me in this way to explain your word, interpret your word week after week, that you'll grant me, oh Lord, the insight into your word, so that the best and what you had in mind when the word was written will be given to your people in Jesus' name. I pray, oh Lord, that as we begin the epistle to the Hebrews, that you'll help us to know the exalted Christ more and more in Jesus' name. Today, Lord, we pray that you exalt Christ before us, so that we'll know who he is, what he does, and who he is to us, so that we'll be able to worship, adore him as we ought to. Open our eyes of understanding, Lord, that we may behold wonderful, wondrous things out of your word. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I welcome you once again to the Bible study today. You remember that last week we began our series of new studies in the Epistle to the Hebrews. And we dealt with verse chapter 1, verse 1, and a part of verse 2. I think I told you then that we're going slowly at the beginning because we're laying a strong foundation. And the Epistle to the Hebrews actually has a lot to teach believers, which many of us have overlooked in the past. And therefore it appears we are covering just a few verses at a time. Understand, number one, is because we're just beginning and we're laying the foundation. Number two, it is because there are rich, rich things in the Epistle to the Hebrews that we cannot just hurry over them as if we do not know the wells that we need to get out of the Epistle. Please open with me to Hebrews chapter 1 from verse 1. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, as in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Let's stop there for a moment. I told you last week of the preeminence of the Lord Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ is greater than anyone or anything in the Old Testament, and that God communicated his mind, his will, his word, his revelation unto the patriarchs and the prophets and the judges and the kings of the Old Testament through the prophets. But now that Jesus Christ has taken the center stage, that Jesus Christ is now the center of the revelation of God, and everything comes through the channel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You remember we emphasized that in the Old Testament, God revealed himself to man through the prophets. Yet, even those prophets did not fully understand the revelation of God. We are told in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 to 12, that those prophets, they were inquiring, they were finding out, diligently searching of the things they were preaching when they prophesied of the grace that should come unto us, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when he testified beforehand of the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. And it was revealed unto them that it will not be fulfilled in their own time, but these things will be fulfilled in our own time. They didn't fully understand, but they were pointing, all of them, they were pointing to Christ. But then now that in this dispensation, Christ has taken the center stage, God's revelation are now understood and fulfilled in Christ. Christ is the supreme and the final revelation. God has fully expressed himself in his only begotten Son. You remember that that woman at the well told the Lord Jesus Christ, I know that the Messiah cometh, which is called the Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. That you find in John chapter 4 verse 25. She knew that when the Messiah arrived, he would unfold the full and the final revelation of God, as indeed Christ did when he came into this world. So then, we studied the first 1.5 verses of the epistle to the Hebrews last week. And we emphasized the preeminence of Christ over all the Old Testament people, patriarchs, princes, prophets, whoever they were. In fact, that Christ is greater than all the message of the Old Testament, all the methods of the Old Testament, all the messengers of the Old Testament. Christ's superiority is established. As we look at these verses, we find that he's greater than the prophets, he's greater than the angels, he's greater than everyone. Today we're looking mainly at verses 2 and 3. In verse 2, he has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Describing that Son, he says, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself poured our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Now you will find that those two verses are talking about Jesus Christ, the very Son of God. In fact, do I need to tell you this? This whole epistle is talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me quickly run with you through some of the chapters of the epistle to the Hebrews. And you will find that there is a concentration on the Lord Jesus Christ. As I told you last week, that Christ actually now has taken the center stage. And as you look at the chapters in the epistle to the Hebrews, you find Jesus Christ, you find him mentioned over and over and over again. And you find his exalted position being referred to over and over again. Follow me as I go through. In Hebrews chapter 1 verse 8, but unto the Son he says, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. It's referring to the Lord Jesus Christ there, and it's referring to him as God. In chapter 2 verse 8, he has put all things in subjection under his feet. You see that? It's the exaltation of Jesus Christ. Verse 9, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor. You see the exaltation of Christ. And then in verse 10 of that same chapter 2, it's telling us that, for it became him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things. You see that? And then it even says, he was to bring many sons to glory. Looking at chapter 3, and in verse 1, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle, the high priest of our profession, who is that? Jesus Christ. It's telling you that as we talk about Jesus Christ as God, you are talking about him as one that has all things under his feet. You are talking about him as one that is crowned with glory and honor. You are talking about him as one that is bringing many sons to glory. You are talking about him as the saint one, the apostle and the high priest of our profession. And then in chapter 4 verse 14, it says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, that this Jesus Christ is no more here on earth. He's so exalted. He has passed into the heavens. And then we're told he's the very Son of God. In chapter 5, verse 5, it tells us, so also Christ glorified not himself to be made an high priest, but he that says unto him, thou art my Son, today have I begotten thee. He's telling us that it wasn't self-glorification. self-exaltation. It was the Father that gave him this exaltation. Chapter 6, verse 20. Whither the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. That is, is not a temporary high priest, is made a priest forever. In chapter 7, verse 22, by so much, what Jesus made is surety of a better covenant. And chapter 8 picks up the same thing about Jesus Christ. Chapter 18, verse 6, but now has he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. In chapter 9, verse 11, but Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come, by greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Chapter 10 tells us of the excellencies of Christ in verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest. In which way? By what means? By the blood of Jesus. Chapter 11, verse 26. That there is the riches, there are the riches or the treasures of Christ. And that is more important than the treasures of Egypt. In chapter 12 and in verse 2, we're told to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And we're told that he sat down at the right hand, at the right hand of the throne of God. In chapter 13, verse 12, this Jesus is the one that sanctifies the people. It is through his blood. And in verse 20 of that same chapter, God, the God of peace, are brought again from the dead, that Lord Jesus Christ is the great shepherd of the sheep. And it is through his blood that we have the everlasting covenant. Now, I've shown you all that to tell you that Christ is at the center stage. And you cannot read the epistle to the Hebrews and talk about any other person, and talk about any other personality, that Jesus Christ is a preeminent one. And actually, in chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, this is what these verses are talking about. They are talking about Jesus Christ. And these verses are talking about the sevenfold presentation of the excellencies of Christ. I've told you that the whole epistle itself concentrates on Christ. There is no study you can have in the epistle to the Hebrews, and it will not be related to Christ. If he talks about Joshua, he's talking about Jesus being greater than Joshua. If he talks about the high priest of the Old Testament, he's talking about Christ being greater than the high priest of the Old Testament. If he talks about Aaron, about Melchizedek, about Moses, he's telling us that Christ is greater than those personalities of the Old Testament. If he talks about the tabernacle of the Old Testament, about the rituals, about the ceremonies, he's talking about Christ being greater than all of them. And therefore, at the very beginning, we're talking of the excellencies of Christ. And we're talking of the sevenfold presentation of the excellencies of Christ. As we look at these short verses 2 and 3, what are the seven excellencies that we're going to be confronted with, or that we're going to encounter? Look at your outline. Number 1, Christ is presented as the heir of all things, is the one that inherits all things. Number 2, Christ is presented as the creator. Not only the creator of the earth in which we live, the creator of the earth, of the sun, of the moon, of the stars, of all the planets, creator of the whole universe. Number 3, Christ is the brightness of the glory of God. Christ, the brightness of the glory of God. Number 4, Christ is the express image of the Father, the express image of God. Number 5, Christ is the sustainer of the whole universe, is the one upholding all things by the might, by the strength, by the power of his word. Number 6, Christ is the perfect sacrifice for sin. Christ, the perfect sacrifice for sin. Number 7, Christ, the exalted priest and king. The very fact that the writer of this epistle mentions these seven things, it's even talking about the completeness of the Lord Jesus Christ, the perfection of the Lord Jesus Christ, because that number seven represents completeness and perfection. Let's now go through them one by one. Please, we'll read a lot from the outline and we'll read a lot from scripture, because these things are very important, very essential. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2. He has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things. It's talking about God appointing Christ. Appointing Christ. It means that God, say it this way, in human language, searched all of earth, all of heaven, among men, and among angels, and there is no other one to appoint, no other one as great, no other one as majestic, no other one to be preferred above Christ, and therefore the Father, having searched in all of heaven and all of earth, he appointed Christ as the heir of all things. Now that is a marvelous thing, that God had no other choice, had no other preference, had no other personality to choose or to appoint to be heir of all things, not among the angels, not among men, not among the prophets, not among the patriarchs, not among any man, before or now or after, in the past, in the present, or in the future. Can you compare with the Lord Jesus Christ? God appointed him to be the heir of all things. I'm going to say another thing. If God has seen the beauty and the majesty and the greatness and the glory of Christ to have appointed him like that, who is your choice? The choice of the Lord of your life, the choice of your Savior, the choice of your Redeemer. Who can be appointed to be your Redeemer, to be your Lord, to be the one that will be the preeminent one, the prominent one in your life? If God saw no other choice apart from Christ, I hope you do not see any other choice apart from Christ. Christ is appointed as the heir of all things. Did Christ know that he was the heir of all things? So yes, he knew. And when he was here on earth, he spoke a number of parables. And he gave a particular parable which you'll find in Matthew, you'll find in Mark, you'll find in Luke. I'm going to read the Mark account. Mark chapter 12. Mark chapter 12. Let's read from verse 1. And he began to speak unto them by parables. A certain man planted a vineyard and set an hedge about it, and digged a place for the wine fat, and built a tower, and let it out to husbandmen, and went into a far country. And at the season he sent to the husbandmen a servant, that he might receive from the husbandmen of the fruit of the vineyard. And he caught him, and beat him, and sent him away empty. And again he sent unto them another servant, and at him they cast stones and wounded him in the head, and sent him away shamefully handled. Again he sent another, and him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some. You know the meaning of the parable? In the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, God sent his servants. He sent the prophet. You see, he revealed his will and his might unto the people of the past generation by the prophets, but at last he said, I will send my only begotten Son. Now in verse 6, having yet therefore one son, his well beloved, he sent him also last unto them, saying, they will reverence my son, which means they will reverence, they will respect, they will honor my son. But those husbandmen said among themselves, this is the heir. Do you understand? They knew that he was the one to inherit all things. God had appointed him as the heir of all things. And then they said, come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. Which means they conspired against him. You know the story of the crucifixion and the death and the burial and then the resurrection. They conspired and said, come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. They didn't know of the resurrection. They thought if they killed him, that would be the end of it. But thank God, they killed him, but then he rose again. And the Father has now appointed him the heir of all things. In John chapter 3. John chapter 3 and in verse 35. John 3:35 tells us the Father loveth the Son and has given all things into his hand. All things literally has been given to the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 13 and verse 3. John 13 verse 3. Jesus, knowing that the Father has given all things into his hands and that he was come from God and went to God. In fact, Jesus knew all this. That is why he declared in John chapter 16 verse 15. In John chapter 16 verse 15 he said, all things that the Father has are mine. So then we know that Christ, as the Son of God, is the heir of all things that God possesses. And here is one who inherits anything or everything from its possessor, usually from the Father. Jesus, as the heir of God the Father, shows that he has the rank and the dignity of the very Son of God. As the Son of God, is the possessor and the Lord of all. You imagine then, who is so rich like Christ? Who can endow his friends with enduring abundant wealth like the Lord Jesus Christ? In fact, everything that exists, exists for Jesus Christ. Everything that exists will find its true meaning only when it comes under the full and final control of the Lord Jesus Christ. Before I leave that point, think about this. That as we come to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, here is the wonder of all wonders. That now, you who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you who are truly saved, you have become joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Here we read this wonderful, marvelous verse in verse 17. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. Well then, the first excellency we study about the Lord Jesus Christ is that Christ is the heir of all things. Now we go to point number two. Hebrews chapter 1 and in verse 2. Hebrews, open your Bible to Hebrews chapter 1 verse 2. God, as in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. By whom also he made the worlds. Here we are told of Christ as the Creator. This second excellency of Christ mentioned in Hebrews chapter 1 is his creatorship. Christ is the agent through whom God created the world, that is, the universe. The ability to create belongs to God alone. And the fact that Jesus creates indicates that he is God. Once again, let us look at other passages of Scripture to make us understand that Christ indeed is the Creator. In John chapter 1, John chapter 1, let's read it from verse 1 until we get to verse 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. How are we sure this is talking about Christ? Verse 14, and the Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So this is talking about Christ. Go back to verse 2. The same Word, the same Christ, the Son of God, the same was in the beginning with God. What is the quality we see in him, his characteristic, or his nature? In verse 3, all things were made by him, and without him was nothing made that was made. That is a confirmation of the very fact that Jesus Christ is Creator. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 6. First Corinthians chapter 8 verse 6. But to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him. Listen to this. And one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 9. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 9. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God. Listen to this. Who created all things? Who created all things? By Jesus Christ. So then, Jesus Christ is the creator, not just of the world in which we live, not just of this earth, but of all the planets, and is the creator of all the things that you can see and the things that you cannot see. Can you think about that for a moment? Even if it were this earth alone, think about the oceans, think about the trees, think about the animals, think about the men, think about all the things in the earth, think about the minerals, the gold and the iron and the silver and the brass and the minerals in the world, in the earth, and the petroleum and the uranium, everything you can think of in this earth, the vastness of the wealth and the riches of all those things on the earth here. And to think about it, that Jesus Christ, when you call him Jesus, when you call him Savior, when you call him Redeemer, you do not know what you are thinking or talking about. You do not know the greatness of his power. You do not know the majesty of his person. When you think of just the earth alone, and to understand that Jesus Christ created it all, what a revelation that we have in Christ. But then we miss something if we're only thinking of the earth. I want you to look at Hebrews again, chapter 1 and in verse 2. It says in the latter part of verse 2, by whom also he made the worlds, plural, with an S. He made the worlds in the plural. When you are thinking of the created things, you are thinking not only of the earth, you are thinking of the whole universe. Can you think of the vastness of this, our universe? Can you think of the sun? Can you think of the moon? Can you think of other stars? In fact, scientists tell us that the nearest star is 5 times bigger or larger than the sun. Can you think of other planets like Mercury, like Pluto, like Venus, like Saturn, like all the others that we cannot even begin to mention? If I were to describe the orbits and the distances and the arrangements and the ordering of the universe to you, it will almost blow your mind. In fact, you cannot even understand the length and the breadth and all the things we're talking about. For example, if you could somehow put more than 1 million Earths, think of the Earth, you think it's very big. You travel to the whole of Africa, to Asia, to America, to Britain, you're still in this world, you're still on this Earth. And when you can put 1 million of this Earth into the sun, that is, into the space, and you will still have room left for about 4.3 moons. Think about it. That the earth is so big. In fact, we are told that the diameter of the sun is 865,000 miles, the diameter alone. And that sun you look at so very far away is 93 million miles from the earth. The nearest star, do you know, I told you, is 5 times larger than the sun. If the sun is so big that you can put 1 million of this earth and 4 million of the moon right into the sun, and there'll still be space. And then we're talking of the nearest star so far away as 5 times our sun. That the moon is 211,463 miles away from us. If you were to walk there and be walking every day, every night, every moment, every minute, you'll be walking for 27 years before you get to the moon. You know the point I'm making? That the earth and the moon and the sun and all the stars are all created by the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know that the scientists have told us that it takes a ray of light 186,000 miles per second in traveling, in moving. And so a beam of light would reach the moon, that is from the sun to the moon, in 1.5 seconds. That is because it travels at 186,000 miles per second. If we could travel at that speed, it will take 2 minutes, 18 seconds to reach another planet, Venus. It will take 4.5 minutes to reach Mercury. It will take 1 hour, 11 seconds to reach Saturn, and so on. To reach Pluto, Pluto is 2.7 billion miles from the Earth. Can you think of 1,000 miles, 1,000,000 miles, 1 billion miles, and then 2.7 billion miles from the Earth? That will take about 4 hours. You know, the light will travel 4 hours before it gets there. Haven't got that far, we're still inside our own solar system. The North Star is 400 trillion miles away. But still, that is even nearby when you are considering the whole of space, because there is another star, Betelgeuse, that is 880 quadrillion miles from the Earth. It has a diameter of 250 million miles, which is greater than even that of the orbit, that is the trajectory, or that is the path through which the Earth is traveling. The question is, as we think of all the universe and the planets and the moon and everything that we have talked about, and I cannot describe it to you, it is so vast, it is so great, it is almost beyond comprehension. Where did it all come from? Who made everything? Because it didn't happen by accident. Somebody made it, and the Bible tells us the maker of it all is Jesus Christ. That makes me jump for joy. That this one I call my Savior, I call my Lord, I call my Redeemer, is so mighty, is so great, that, you know, he made all the worlds. You know, when we think about these miracles, that he multiplied bread for 5,000, we think that is a great miracle. When we think that he walked on the sea, we think that is a great miracle. When we think that he fed the 4,000 and the women and the children with bread, we think that is a great miracle. In fact, when we think of the resurrection, that he rose from the dead because he has the spirit of life within him, we say, what a great miracle. In fact, we'll say that is a measure of the greatness of the miracle he can perform. But then you begin to think now that Jesus Christ did not only multiply bread, did not only multiply fish, he created all these planets we're talking about. When you get to heaven and you see the majesty of Christ, you see the greatness of Christ, you see the power of Christ, you'll fall at his feet. Except he touches you, you'll not be able to rise up. Because you'll just worship him. The wonder, the greatness, the majesty that you'll behold. When we eventually get to heaven, you will know that this Christ we're talking about is excellent and is great. At the mention of his name, no wonder that all knees will bow at the mention of his name. I've told you about two excellencies of Christ. Number one, Christ is the heir of all things. Number two, Christ is the creator. Now I go to number three, Christ, the brightness of God's glory. This is another thing. To think about this, of the quality of Christ, of the greatness of Christ, that is the very brightness of the glory of God. Look at Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory. How can we explain this? It's the radiance of the glory of God. Radiance means the sending forth of the light. As you see God, unapproachable light, invisible light, that is so majestic, that is so great, actually Christ himself that came in the world here is the brightness, the radiance of the glory of God. The only radiance that reaches us from God is that radiance mediated to us from the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, just as the rays of the sun lights and also warm the earth, so Jesus Christ is the glorious light of God shining into the hearts of men. Just as the sun was never without and cannot be separated from its brightness, so God cannot be separated from the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you separate the sun and the brightness? No, you can never. Because the sun retains its brightness, and the brightness is attached to the sun. That's why Jesus said, I and my Father are one. The sun and its brightness, they are one. You cannot separate one from the other. Not only that, how do you really know the sun? How do you see the sun? It is the brightness of the sun that makes you to know what the sun is all about. Christ is fully and absolutely God, because there's no separation between God and Christ, between the sun and its rays or its brightness. And yet, Christ is distinct from the Father. We could never be able to see or enjoy God's light if we didn't have Jesus Christ to look at. Without Jesus Christ, the Son of God, everything is darkness. God sent His light in the person of Jesus Christ, that man might behold and accept and radiate that light. Jesus Christ is the radiance of the glory of God. He can transmit that light into your life, so that you in turn can radiate the glory of God. Let me talk a little about this from Scripture. As we're talking about Christ, the brightness of the glory of God, look at John chapter 1 verse 14 again. We read it before, it bears reading again. John chapter 1 and in verse 14. It says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Listen to this. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. That's what Jesus said in John chapter 8 and in verse 12. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. You see, He radiates the brightness of the Father, the brightness of the glory of the Father. And He could say, I am the light of the world. Without me, the world will be in darkness. What could you know of morals? What could you know of spirituality? What could you know of wisdom? What could you know of intelligence? What do you know, what would you know of the glory and the greatness and the power and the brightness of the Father, except through the Lord Jesus Christ? I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Now, when Jesus Christ was here in the world, that glory was veiled. That is, He made Himself of no reputation. But there was a particular time that He allowed a little bit of that glory, of that brightness, to be manifested. And of course, the disciples could not bear that. Look at Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17, and you will see that when He allowed that glory, that brightness to shine a little, the people could not bear it. Matthew chapter 17 and in verse 2. And He was transfigured before them, and His face did shine as the sun, and His raiment was white as the light. But the Lord had to veil that glory and that brightness so that the people will be able to relate with Him and touch Him and listen to Him and eat with Him. Then there was a time that John the Beloved saw this glory, just a part of that glory, and he was flattened on the ground. He could not bear it. He fell to the ground as one dead. Look at it in Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1, reading from verse 12. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a raiment down to the foot, and girt about the pass, about the chest, with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. The lightness, the whiteness, the flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burnt in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. You see that? Verse 17, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. The brightness of the glory of the Father. And Jesus had to touch him to get him away from the dirt, from the soil, from the ground. Then you see that really, when you think about Christ, many people don't know Christ. If anybody will compare Christ with any prophet in the Old Testament, that person does not really know Christ. If anybody will compare Christ with the patriarchs or the princes or the priests in the Old Testament, that person does not know Christ. If anybody will say, well, Jesus Christ is like one of the angels, that person does not really know Christ. Can you refer to any angel? Can you refer to any man as the inheritor, as the heir of all things? Can you refer to any angel as the creator of the whole universe? Can you refer to any angel as the brightness of the glory of God? No, not at all. Christ occupies a special place in the heart of the Father, and on the throne beside the Father, and also in the whole of heaven, and also in the universe, and also in the understanding and the heart of the believer. We are spoken about three excellencies. Number one, Christ, the heir of all things. Number two, Christ, the creator of the whole universe. Number three, Christ, the brightness of the glory of God. Now, number four, Christ, the express image of God. Every part that we see gives us another view, a greater view, an understanding of who Jesus Christ is. And I cannot tell you the extent of my joy, the scope of my joy, as I know that this Christ is my Savior, that he makes me his child. He even calls me his friend, and he calls you his friend if you believe in him. Can you imagine that such a great, mighty, majestic Christ will call you the redeemed one and his friend, and he will even reveal himself and reveal the Father unto you? Number four, Christ, the express image of God. It says in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his Son. Express image of his Son. Jesus Christ is the express image of God. That is God in essence, is God in reality, is God in substance. Christ is the exact resemblance of God. The resemblance between his stamp and the figure which is impressed is exact. How do I explain that to you? If on a wet rainy day, if you are wearing a shoe, and that shoe has some kind of drawing or marks at the sole of the foot, when you put it on the ground, you remove it, you'll see the impress, you'll see the image, the exact resemblance on the ground, because that is the resemblance of the sole of the shoe. Or if it was a wax, and you put a stamp on that wax, you'll see the replica, the resemblance of that stamp on the wax. In that same way, Christ is the resemblance, the express image of the Father. There is no way you can separate Christ from God. He is God himself. Put it this way, God is invisible. Christ became visible. Christ is the visible expression of the invisible God. Christ is the visible expression of the invisible God. In Colossians chapter 1 and in verse 15. Colossians chapter 1 verse 15. Who is the image of the invisible God? The firstborn of every creature. Here we are, the Jehovah's Witnesses are going to say, there you are now, he is a firstborn of every creature. Actually, you know that is talking about the first. It's talking about the chief. The Greek there is prototokos, and it's talking about the first one, the preeminent one among all people. And it's telling you that it's above everyone and above everything. It's the visible image of the invisible God. When Christ was here on earth, he was the brightness of the divine glory. the express image of his person. He was the embodied representation of the deity. He was pure, just like God. He was benevolent, just like God. He healed diseases exactly like God, only God could do. He raised the dead, only like God could do. He wielded power, which God only could wield. His form was that of man, his spirit was that of God. Now you need to understand the twofold nature of Christ as he came into this world. There were things he did that showed that he actually put on our flesh, man. And there were things he did that showed that he still retained that very nature of God. He was God. Think about this. He walked and ate and slept how? Like a man. But he thought and spoke and acted like God. He was born how? Like a man. But then angels worshipped and adored him like who? Like God. As God. As a man, he ate, yet by a word, he created food for thousands like only God could do. Like a man, he slept on a pillow while the sheep was tossed by the waves. But like God, he rose and rebuked the winds, and the winds were calm. As a man, he sympathized with the bereaved. But then like God, he spoke, and the dead came forth to the land of the living. As a man, he died on the cross and he slept in a cold tomb. But then, like God, he arose and he brought life and immortality to light. He lived on earth as a man. Then he ascended to heaven like God. Christ is the exact resemblance of the essence of God. That's what the Bible says. If you look at John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Reading from verses 8 and 9. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it suffices us. Show us God. Show us the Almighty. Show us the great I am that I am. Show us the Omnipotent One. Show us the One in heaven. Show us the Father, and it suffices us. Jesus saith unto him, Have I been so long with you, Philip? Have I been so long with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father, capital F. He that has seen me has seen God. He that has seen me has seen the great I am that I am. He that has seen me has seen the Almighty. How sayest thou, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? You cannot make a separation. You cannot make an exact total distinction, because the words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the words. He's telling you that Christ is the exact image of the Father. Let's now go on to number 5. Christ, the sustainer of the universe. Christ, the sustainer of the universe. You know, maintenance is so difficult. If you look at the industries, you'll find that there are cries. In fact, in Africa in particular, they tell us that maintenance is a problem. It is one thing to make that machine. It is one thing to have all those gadgets and all those buildings and everything. But to maintain and to sustain, that's another thing. We've talked of Jesus Christ as the creator. But can you think of the thousands of years that this world had been, that the planets had been, that the sun had been, that the moon had been, the stars had been, and to understand that since the creation, everything has been upheld. How? By Christ, the sustainer of the whole universe. In Hebrews chapter 1, Hebrews chapter 1, reading again from verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. Upholding all things, all the worlds, all the universe, everything that goes into space. You know, the scientists, they couldn't predict anything except that things are ordered by the power of the Lord. There's the law of gravity. In fact, do you know that the scientists could predict the eclipse of the sun? They could predict the tornadoes and the volcanoes and a lot of things. Why? Because of the ordering, the arrangement of everything. Everything is upheld and everything can be timed. You can send those rockets and those jets into the moon or into space. Why? Because everything is predictable. Everything is upheld by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything in the universe is sustained right now by Jesus Christ. We are told it is by him you have the upholding of all things, by the word of his power. That is, by the powerful word or command of the Lord Jesus Christ. He upholds, he sustains all things, the rocks and the mountains and the seas and the animals and the men and the earth and the universe and the distant worlds in the plural, the universe. This distant planet by the word of his power. We need to say this once again. You cannot compare Christ with the prophets. You cannot compare Christ with any angel. There is none on earth, in heaven, apart from Almighty God, you can compare with Christ. He who can hold up the vast universe so that it does not sink into anarchy. He must be God. He must be God. He cannot be a mere angel. He cannot be a mere man. He is God. But something gives me joy here. You know, if Christ can uphold the universe and the planets and the moon and the sun and the earth and everything by the word of his power, no doubt he can uphold my life. No doubt he can arrange and order and put into place every little thing in my life. There is nothing to fear. He can keep me from falling. He can keep me stable. He can keep me calm. He can arrange all circumstances in my life so that I'll be able to see his face on the last day. If he upholds the universe and the world by the word of his power, he can uphold your life. Can you imagine what will happen if Jesus Christ relinquished his sustaining power over the laws of the universe? We would go out of existence in a moment of time if he did that. If he suspended the law of gravity only for a brief moment, we would perish in unimaginable ways, because the mountains will slide into the ocean, the seas will splash on the ground, and the trees and everything will empty themselves into the valleys, and there will be confusion in the sea and on the earth, and buildings will collapse, and things that are suspended, they will not be able to move at a predicted rate anymore, because for a moment he suspends the law of gravity. But thank God, Christ with his permanent power upholds and maintains and sustains all things. And you know then that your life can be upheld by the Lord, can be sustained by the Lord. In fact, a life like a universe that is not sustained by Christ will be in utter chaos. Think about your life. If your life is not sustained by Christ, it will be in utter chaos. Let's go to number 6. Christ, the perfect sacrifice for sin. We've been talking about power, about might, about strength, about wisdom, about majesty, about glory, about brightness, about everything concerning Christ. And this is the most beautiful of them all. Because, you know, without this one, all that power may crush us. All that power may create the world. All that power may do some mighty, majestic things. But then they will not get us related to the Lord. They will not reconcile us to God. They will not give us a place in heaven. But to think of the excellency of Christ as the perfect sacrifice for sin, we can sing for all eternity about it. We can rejoice for all eternity because of it, that Christ is the perfect sacrifice for sin. Sin came in between man and God. Sin separated us from the Almighty, but now Christ came in all his power. He made himself of no reputation. He emptied himself of all his glory temporarily, and he came into this world to become the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And because of that, now our sins can be cleansed away. Look at it in Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3. who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power, when he has by himself, not by an angel, by himself, not by a priest of the old covenant, by himself, not by a father of the present day Catholic Church, by himself, purged our sins. That is wonderful. The purging is a cleansing. The purging is the forgiveness. The purging is the purifying. He now pardons, he now forgives, he now cleanses, he now justifies, he now purges and purifies us from our sins. What a great thing that he does. That is not the final sacrifice. Look at John. You knew this before, but refresh your memory with this and have faith in this. In John chapter 1 verse 29, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. By himself he purges our sin. This is a glorious attribute of Christ, a glorious excellency of Christ. In Hebrews chapter 9 verse 12. Hebrews chapter 9 verse 12. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Having obtained eternal redemption for us. The word eternal there is wonderful. It tells us that it is eternal. And the redemption is not just for 1 week, it's not just for 1 month, it's not just for 1 year. It can last your lifetime. In fact, it is eternal. And it is by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 13, for if the blood of bulls and of goats and of the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying of the flesh. That is, if the blood of the bulls of the Old Testament, the goats of the Old Testament, will purify. How about this one that is greater than angels, greater than men, greater than the high priest sacrificing the animal, greater than the animals, of course, greater than everything and everyone? How much more, that's in verse 14 now, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Now we can be purged. Now we can be cleansed. Now we can be purified. We can even be sanctified. And the very nature of sin can be dealt with in our hearts, in our lives. And now we can freely and fully serve the living God. In Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2 and in verse 14. Titus 2:14. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. From all iniquity, no exception. And purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Zealous of good works. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. It was not just to teach that Christ came. It was to purify the hearts of men, to remove our sins, and to put an end to the sacrifices of the Old Testament, so that he will be the final and the perfect sacrifice. Jesus Christ dealt with the sin problem once and for all. He had to do it. It had to be done. We could not communicate with God or enter into fellowship with him unless sin was dealt with. And so Christ went to the cross and bore the penalty for sin, for all who would accept a sacrifice and believe in him and receive him. By sacrifice now, sin has been purged. Sin has been wiped out, not to be remembered again, and not to have authority or power, influence over us anymore. Yes, in the past, we all sinned. And neither could we pay the penalty of sin except by having eternal punishment going to hell. But now we can accept Jesus Christ, who has made the final payment for our sins in sacrificing himself, for which we receive now eternal life. If we turn away from all our sins and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, our sins are washed away and we are given grace to live right. Those who die in their sins will suffer forever, but those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ will live forever in the presence of God to enjoy life eternal. Then let's go to Hebrews chapter 1 as we round up the qualities and the excellencies of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, the first excellency of the Lord Jesus Christ, He is Christ, the heir of all things. Number 2, is Christ the creator of the whole universe. Number 3, is Christ the brightness of the glory of God. Number 4, Christ the express image of God. Number 5, Christ the sustainer of the universe. Number 6, Christ the perfect sacrifice for sin. Now number 7, the perfect number. Number 7, Christ the exalted priest and king. In verse 3, the latter part of verse 3, sat down on the right hand of majesty on high. Maybe you say, there is no what priest here, there is no what king here. How then do we say that this quality is talking about the exalted priest and king? Well, look at other references that will back up that one. Hebrews chapter 8 verse 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is a sum, this is a summary. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. You know what we read in verse 3 over there? He sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. And we have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. In chapter 10 of Hebrews and verse 12, but this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, he sat down on the right hand of God. Sat down on the right hand of God. The marvelous thing about this last excellency of Christ is that he, the perfect high priest, sat down after he had by himself purged our sins. This is in great contrast to the priestly procedure under the old covenant. There were no seats in the tabernacle or in the temple sanctuaries. Why? Because the Old Testament priest could not sit because he had to keep on sacrificing day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year. The sacrifices never ended. And therefore they went on and on and on. There was no seat in that tabernacle for them. But Jesus offered one sacrifice and then he said, it is finished. It's all done. It will not be repeated again. The sacrifice for your sin is already accomplished. The blood that will cleanse all your sins away and make you pure, make you pardoned, make you perfect. Everything had been shed. It is finished. And now Christ is seated on the right hand of majesty on high. Now you can look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. He's done it all, and the sacrifice is never to be repeated. Now you can believe on him and be saved. Now you can believe on him and be sanctified. Now you can believe on him and you find that the sin problem has now been finally dealt with once and for all. He then sat down with the Father. The final sacrifice had been offered. Now Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for those who believe in him. As we look at what we have studied today, we have looked at Christ the preeminent one. And we have seen Christ at the center stage again. Not just at the center stage in heaven, not just at the center stage in the church, at the center stage in the whole universe. Think about Christ. That when you get to heaven, and you find and you look on the throne, you see the Lamb on the throne. When you look at the church and you are looking for the head of the church, you see Christ, the head of the church. You even look at the universe and you are thinking of the one that upholds the universe, and it is Christ. In heaven, in the church, in the world, in the universe, is the one that has taken the center stage, the heir of all things, the creator of the universe, the brightness of the glory of God, the express image of God, the sustainer of the universe, the perfect sacrifice, the exalted priest and king. And what a wonderful privilege that you belong to him. You are a child of God, you are redeemed, you are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that he raised, and that we will be co-heirs with him, we'll inherit all things with him, we're going to reign with him. I believe you'll want to stand up and pray. You'll want to praise the Lord that such a Savior is this. What a Savior! Exalted in heaven, exalted in the church, exalted in the universe. What a Savior! I want you now to stand up and pray and talk to the Lord and bring to mind all these excellencies of Christ we have spoken about, and pray point by point, and then realize if you are born again, you are a child of God. He's able to uphold your life, he's able to sustain you, he's able to keep you pure and perfect without sin, because he now lives in you by his power. If he's able to uphold the whole universe, he's able to uphold your life, because your life is secure and safe in his Son. Pray and really glorify, worship the Lord before you leave today. And come next Monday again as we continue to see the exaltation of Christ, and how we get into the ministries of angels, a lot of things we're going to talk about. Let others come along with you too. No member of the church should meet Bible studies like this. Talk to the Lord and pray.